Find out what's going on. Get involved. Change things from the inside. Make a difference. Take pride. Multicultural at its best. The Luisa Marshall Show. Coming up.
Previously on Simply the Best. Highlights of our visit inside the Artifacts of Freedom in Saskatoon, Saskatchewan.
The Saskatoon Modelers Club actually made this up for us. And they came right down in very, very good detail. This is a Ross rifle, which was Canadian made for the for our forces. And it was a excellent arm.
Chuck Lochel told us important details and interesting information of some artifacts in the museum.
This is very interesting, and some people do not know about it. We have Native soldiers. Obviously, we had Native soldiers during the war, both World Wars. And these were the most interesting to me, were not only were they very highly decorated, the Native, this is a replica of one of the Native soldiers in his awards. The wool is actually cool in the summer too. Yeah, and it dries faster too when you get wet, so.
Here's the continuation of Artifacts of Freedom and some Proud Mary highlights.
One of the things that amazes me most is that the women, they could fly a fighter one day, a bomber another day, and maybe a transport plane the next day. They were quite a boon to the war effort, shall we say. So the women in the Air Force, and they were just auxiliary people.
Viewers, we're still in Saskatoon and we're still down here at the Nutana Legion Artifacts Museum. This is just incredible. I hope any one of you who would be traveling and passing through Saskatoon in Saskatchewan, maybe you should stop by and visit this wonderful place. Just incredible.
Lots of memorabilia. Models of uniforms in here, and you can see these guys have some of their medals on. We actually have what they represent in here. This is the 1939-45 star, the Atlantic star, the defense medal, some of the medals that we won, so we stuck them inside their vest pockets, so in case somebody asked. This is a replica of the Bismarck, German battleship Bismarck. Why do we have it in a Canadian War Museum or artifacts room? The story behind it is, this is my favorite here, is because this was made by a German prisoner of war who was sent to a prisoner of war camp in the Sault Ste. Marie area. During his time there, during when he wasn't sent out on work projects, because we have no men here, they were sent to the Sault Ste. Marie and various other camps to cut the wood, make roads, and stuff like that. They made use of the prisoners, and okay. But in the evenings, he decided he was going to make a model of the Bismarck. Well, I don't think he actually ever saw the Bismarck, actually, because it's not a real replica of the Bismarck. It is a replica of a battleship. The American and the British had three-gun turrets on their main guns, whereas the British, or the actual Bismarck, only had two-gun turrets. You can see the two guns here, and you can see he's got three guns in there. So he probably, when he was being shipped over, he saw an American or a British battleship, and this is what I'm going to build. Okay, but anyhow, he's got Bismarck on the side of it and whatever. Now, how does a German battleship wind up in Saskatoon? When the war was over, he could not take this with him. He gave it to his guard, at the Sault Ste. Marie camp. That guard happened to be from Yorkton area. And the guard took this home initially to the Yorkton Museum or Legion. And eventually the Legion had to conserve some space, I guess. Then it went into the family's hand. The family didn't want it anymore and they heard about us. They asked us if we wanted it and we said, of course we'll take it. It's the story behind it is what it is. But and by the way, once this is the battleship here. It had a 2,000 man complement on it, and you can see the waste of war. When this went down, only 200 survived. It sunk the British famous battleship, the Mighty Hood, and it had a 1,600 man complement. Only 99 survived that one. So it's really scary, but that was war, that was then, this is now. More uniforms, current day uniforms here. The knot here for a ship's bell. The guys used to make these things themselves in the ship's bell, yeah, ding, ding, yeah. Ding, ding. Exactly. And so they would make them here. This was apparently on the Saskatoon, model of the a very detailed model of the HMCS Saskatoon. So this is our ship, named after Saskatoon. We were given this ship's wheel, and we had it on a little transportable dolly in here, and it just didn't look right. So we put it on here so the kids could actually say, get in here and steer the ship. Again, the Modelers Club made us a nice diorama of the different battleships and aircraft carriers of the period, Japanese, German, the Royal Navy, and the U.S. Navy here. We have them all identified so you can see which is which. The workmanship that's in here is just phenomenal. The detail is what I really mean here. All the Navy uniforms had trade badges. So you can see what this guy over here, this one here, she was like a stenographer or something, like a ship's clerk, okay? So they all had their trades on their uniforms, so you could tell which was which, and he was a fire control man, photographer, there you go, naval airman, electrician's mate. This is a like a war bonds poster, original, World War I. The British had been in the war since 39, and they had people all over the world. They did not have very many manpower, because they lost a few during the years. Actually, they would turn ships over to the Canadians, and they would be manned by Canadian people. Okay, there would be the British ships, the same as the destroyer or the battleship 544 over here. Yeah. The old hammocks that the fellas used to live in. This was, he's studying his knots right there. But the hammock was a very smart idea at the time, because when the ship swayed, it went with it, so you didn't get too much motion sickness. Various signal flags that they used to put up, which gave you a signal as to if they're turning left or if it's going to be good weather or we're just staying here for the night, fellas, or something. So they would put these up on the mast and stuff. So we have all this identification.
So right now, my viewers, Chuck's taking us to the area where the Air Force memorabilia is.
This used to be, a radio transmitter that you would find in the plane. And sometimes it would probably be right between the pilot's legs, because look at the size of the equipment now, okay? This would be a little handheld device, yeah. Modern day Now, this was his sending and receiving transmitter, so he could call him where he was at and stuff like that. So, but that had to be fit into the plane. So it was bomb load, ammunition load, how much fuel he could carry with all this stuff and still make it as fast as possible so he could get out of trouble.
We still have much more after this. Don't go away.
This here is a very interesting World War II gadget, if you can see it in here. This is the bomb aimer's device. So if you can see the intricacy of this thing here, this told the bombardier when to let go of the bombs. Now imagine if you're in a Lancaster bomber and it's flying along at 300 miles an hour at maybe 30,000 feet with a wind speed, cross speed of 30 miles an hour. How do you get the bombs? Because the bomb isn't going to drop like this. Okay, when you go over target, you have to let it go beforehand. So it has to go down like this because it's traveling with the speed of the airplane, and then it will start slowing down. But then they also have to calculate in the wind speed, the yaw of the aircraft, and how fast it's going, and how high they are up from the ground. So this device told them how to do it, or helped them do it. This was always an officer's job, an educated man. It's all pulleys and wires and angles and stuff. So everything moved on it, direction, compass, everything. And the guy's in an airplane, 30,000 feet in the air, and he's trying to hit that city or a bomb dump, or, you know, 2 miles away. And he's going like that. Just amazing. Women's uniforms during the time here, women in the Air Force, we have, oh, the Air Transport Auxiliary. Because we had so many men qualified to fly airplanes overseas, we didn't have anybody in Canada or North America, to be in fact, because it was all over North America, the U.S. and the women pilots ferried them from the factories to the coast and or overseas. Women flew the bombers, the fighters, everything, overseas. One of the things that amazes me most is that the women, they could fly a fighter one day, a bomber another day, and maybe a transport plane the next day. They were quite a boon to the war effort, shall we say. So the women in the Air Force and and they were just auxiliary people. They weren't official people.
Wow.
Really, too.
Women.
They got the royal uniform, but and I don't think they got the same pay as the guys. The chart behind it there, it would give you the pitch of the whistle. Dress belts, uniforms. Dress uniform.
Oh, that's nice.
This was a flight suit. This is our library, and we're still sorting through books here. All kinds of VHS. Cassettes about the war and history. We go through World War I, World War II, the Korean War, even there's stuff on the German military and stuff. Peacekeepers section here.
Oh, yeah.
With the blue berets and stuff, the blue helmets, and some of their helmets that they wore. You can feel the weight of that thing. How would you like to wear Peacekeepers field kit? This here is an ejection seat. Pilots, emergency escape seat. Use more artifacts of the different planes, and I don't know how much to tell you here.
Wow, that's just more artifacts. This is really interesting.
You've heard of the movie The Great Escape? Turn this down here. This is a diorama or a picture of all the guys, the movie that they made during The Great Escape. This is what they did. This was the camp here. This is one of the Stalag Luft 3 Sagan And this was how they went down. They drilled down through. This is the barracks for the fellas here. And the guards' towers looking over here. So they went down. They made little trolleys to get through it. You saw most of it in the movie. And then they would get out up through here. These were all the guys who escaped. But that wasn't it. How many here? 76 made it out before morning of the 250. Now they're in the group of men. There were 6 Canadians. Most of them were caught and executed. Adolf Hitler ordered 50 of the participants, 50 of these guys, to be executed.
Oh, they caught them.
They caught them. Most of them. A few made it out. Out. But they caught them. No, they had their papers and stuff, but they were all. So 50 of these guys here were eventually tracked down by the Germans, and Hitler ordered them executed. But they had to do it because that's part of the soldier's job, to keep the enemy busy while, you know, World War II. Even so, even the double wing jobs, they're not necessarily all World War I. They were used as trainers to get the guys familiar with the aircraft, and still they were used as, because they had short landing and takeoff, the double wings, because they had the two wings, they could get off aircraft carriers a lot easier. More different uniforms here. And where is Mr. Condra here? Mr. Condra, he is one of our initial, or one of the major pushes when this here artifacts room came into being. Yes, Second World War veteran William Condra. You can see he's aged a little bit here. But he was one of the major pushes here. Marcel Coulinaire, he's one of a local lawyer. He became a local lawyer here in town and stuff. I've been here since 1980, so I remember some of these guys and their names. And these are the aircraft that they flew. But it was an old Corps, Second World War crew that started up this museum, and we've just been trying to keep it up and going ever since there. Why is there a yellow plane here?
Why?
It's a trainer. They train. They painted all the trainer planes yellow, and especially during the Second World War, they had training bases all over the flatlands, all over Western Canada, because there weren't too many mountains to fly into and stuff like that. And you're taking some cases farm boys right off the farm that drove Dad's Massey Ferguson tractor and put them in an airplane. We lost a few of them. Yellow is easier to find. In the wintertime, it stands out. In the summertime, when the fields are green, a yellow aircraft. There he is. That's how we found them. They didn't all crash and burn, but sometimes they ran out of fuel, or they just had to land and error and miss. They find them easier. You just fly up there. There's the yellow, something yellow down in the field that shouldn't be there. A lot easier to find. Different aircraft that the Allied forces flew in. The Typhoon, the Spitfire, you heard of it, the Hurricane. The two main planes that saved the Battle of Britain, that fought in the Battle of Britain. The Curtiss Kitty Hawk, that was a U.S. plane design and stuff. Some modern stuff here with the jet engines there and the Gloster Gladiator. But these here would start out in two wingers because they were easier to fly. And these things here were so fast, they were like bullets for the time, but now you have jet engines that can go twice as fast as what they did. Axis aircraft here, the Japanese, the Germans, and the Italian models here. One last thing I'll show you here. This is a flight suit that they had to wear. Consider it the forerunner of the snowmobile suit, because these things here, Sometimes there were open cockpits. They couldn't even cover up this here guy. So when you get up there, it gets pretty cold. This is what the fellas had to wear. They had to dress them in woolies. So the original snowmobile suit. Here's one fellow that had a ditch, and he's in his little dinghy here. And this is the radio that he has between his direction finder radio that he has between his knees. We have a local Saskatoon man who was Lieutenant Boyce. Originally, he was a cavalry officer, okay? And he kept myriad copious notes, a lot of notes. All the soldiers at that time, this is a sergeant's notepad here, but they all had their little diaries. And he wrote something, what he did every day. He eventually was shot down and became a prisoner of war. He was shot down by von Richthofen's cousin. He survived the crash, obviously. And this was the camp that he was in. You can see his name here. Lieutenant Boyce is there. And this is pictures of him while he was a prisoner of war. And they did try and tunnel out of the section there. And he eventually made it back to Saskatoon. He continued his education because he already had some education. He was an officer. He eventually graduated as a lawyer. He got the job as the sheriff of Saskatoon. So a lot of history in this town.
Lots of history, Chuck. Yeah. Wow, this is simply amazing.
Thanks to Chuck, his wife Joan, to the wonderful staff of Nutana Legion, to the staff of Artifacts of Freedom. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Shout out to Evan and John. Thank you guys, you're wonderful. Love ya. Please don't drink and drive, don't text and drive, always be kind. Let's stop bullies. See you next week for more inspiration. Bye-bye. Thank you, Legion.